you hear me?
Okay.
Okay, so let me start by thanking the organizers for the invitation. It's a wonderful opportunity for me to come to Greek and to speak at this talk in this remarkable audience. It's a report we did with Pedro Alvarez among Mr. Valenzuela. And it's on a subject which is orthogonal to most of the talks in this conference. And so it's probably not as interesting as many things to most of you. But after 5 minutes, when you realize that I'm talking about, you might start checking your email or sending messages. Okay, so this is the work about supersymmetry. Supersymmetry is a remarkable symmetry in the sense that it's a completion of contouring invariants and has many advantages, but it has one big disadvantage, that it has never been seen. And so all these concentrated symmetries. So why should we care about supersymmetry? Why is it that we're interested in supersymmetry thinking? Well, these are the advantages. Supersymmetry is a non-trivial extension of the quantum ray group. It has a possibility of including in the same package internal symmetries and space-time symmetries. It's also a natural unification of fermions and bosons. Fermions and bosons are two aspects of the same reality. It has the other, for me, a big advantage is that supersymmetric theories have fewer parameters. Since you have this very strong symmetry relating different fields, there are very few coupling constants that can be adjusted. Most of them become constrained. There is another advantage that the energy in supersymmetric theories becomes as a quadratic operator, which is positive definite or semi-definite, and therefore you have a bound for energy. And this means that supersymmetric theories are stable and many other things. The practical advantage of that is that, for instance, you have cancellation of infinities in supersymmetric theories that make them more easy to renormalize. Also, the fact that there is no renormalization of some of these constants means that you have parameters which are protected by supersymmetry, and therefore the energy scales of different levels of the theory standard model are protected. Therefore, you can explain hierarchy appearing in supersymmetric theories in this way. Also, there is a claim that the coupling constants in a supersymmetric standard model come together, so the weak, strong electromagnetic coupling constants become one single number at high energy. The other thing is that since supersymmetry can integrate space-time and internal symmetry, there is a possibility of having gravity included, and this is the supergravity extension, which is a very promising idea that was also demonstrated. This is also being used for technical string theory as an improvement to the standard string theory, and it's been proposed as candidates for dark matter and other exotic things. Now, there is a supersymmetric standard model. Actually, there's more than one. There are many standard models which use supersymmetry. And they can be very fashionable in the particle physics phenomenon. Now, the other thing that comes with supersymmetry is that for every particle, there is another supersymmetric particle. And this is an interesting feature because it means that it's very easy to check whether you have supersymmetry in nature or not, because you should see this. Well, unfortunately, the experiments, and especially the KHC, have shown no sign of supersymmetry. There's no sign of this doubling of particles and superparticles. And there's people now claiming that maybe supersymmetry doesn't exist at all. Well, and the main thing about supersymmetry that I find difficult to swallow is that it's not a required symmetry. As we see, fermions and bosons in nature come in very different packages. They serve for different purposes. These are leptons and quarks, and these are interaction carriers. These leptons and quarks are building blocks of matter, and the fermions are all that, right, of that nature. Whereas bosons are all interaction fields. So they're made, or they appear in nature naturally, for different purposes. If you look at the process in high-energy physics, you see that bosons appear in the intermediaries of interactions, whereas fermions are this straight line, this continuous line, never changing. And this is because matter is made by fermions and these are just interactions. Now, let me try to summarize what are the features of fermions and bosons. So, fermions are carriers of conserved charges, like the electron. They have conserved current, therefore, the electromagnetic current, which is K. They are still one half irreducible representations of the Lorentz group. We know of no other distinct half of semi-integer spin particles, except spin one half particles. They are mathematically zero forms. They are sections of the primal bundle for the gauge group. And they transform as vectors in under gauge transformations. They are scalars on the general Bohrian transformations because they don't live in the base manifold, they live actually in the tangent space or in the leak in the vapor. And they satisfy first order field equations. So the fact that they're spin one half fields is carried by some spinner index and their vectors and they carry another gauge index. So under gauge transformations they transform this way. Well, as vectors they have one representation. They have one index, therefore bosons, on the other hand, have the interaction and they are manifestations of the local symmetry. They appear because nature has local symmetry. They're not necessarily conserved, they're created and destroyed, and they appear as intermediaries in the interaction. There are still one half irreducible representations of the Lorentz group, and that means that there is an index associated with that. There are connections in the gauge group, that means that they're in the adjoint representation of the gauge group. They're Lie algebra divided one forms, and they're covariant vectors of the general Bohrian transformations because of this fact. They satisfy second order field equations like Maxwell's equations. And they transform in a very different way. They transform inhomogeneously, they have this extra term. So if you compare fermions and bosons as they appear in that theory, they have very different ways of transforming under gauge groups. So the question then arises, why should you expect to be that these fields are part of the same object or something like that? Well, the way supersymmetry is implemented in the standard rigid supersymmetry or global supersymmetry, as it's called, is that you have bosons and fermions in a representation that transforms with the supersymmetry generator, which is a matrix that mixes bosons and fermions in this way. And this matrix or this operator commutes with Hamiltonian, and therefore you have conserved charge associated with that. And in particular, this means that the energy eigenstates of the bosons and fermions are equal. So you have a degeneracy of mass coming from this problem. And this is the signal that you would expect in supersymmetric theory, although it's said, obvious for everybody that this supersymmetry therefore must be broken in nature. So it's interesting that you have introduced a symmetry which you know from start that has to be broken. I'm very happy broken. It's not approximate. It's not like the symmetry between neutrons and protons, hypergenes. But that the trick that people in supersymmetric field proposes that for every particle you have a supersymmetric particle. So for all fermions you have this S fermions, and for every intermediate boson you have the bosino. So you duplicate all the particles in nature. Well, this is going the opposite direction from unification. Instead of having unification, you have duplication of everything. And the question is whether this is really necessary. Is there an experiment that supports this kind of evidence? Well, not really. There is a famous quote from Alfonso X, one of the kings of Spain, the middle ages, who said that when he looked at Ptolemy's cosmology, looking at all the epicycles, He said, if the Lord had consulted my opinion, I would have suggested something to super simple. The same thing he said about super simple. There is another quote that I would like to bring in. It's an opinion affirming term about a very interesting and very beautiful model of Dyson, in which he tried to describe strong interaction by just repeating what had been the successful model of QED. This was in the early 50s, but electrodynamics had just been proposed and understood. So Dyson said, well, if we've done electrodynamics, let's do strong interactions. So he proposed a very interesting model where the photon was replaced by a scalar field and so forth. So Fermi looked at it, and he said, well, there are two ways of doing calculations in zero layer physics. One way is to have a clear physical picture of the process that you're calculating. Maybe you have good experimental evidence of what's going on, and you understand what's going on. And the other way is to have a precise, self-consistent mathematical formula. You have neither. So I think that was the end of this proposed theory of strong interactions. And it was really timely because 10 years after this, many people discovered that it was quarks and gluons, and it was not protons and neutrons that had the main role in strong interactions. So let me see, I'm trying to discuss with you a possibility of doing something slightly different. So let's try to combine terms and bosons, respecting their mathematical differences, that bosons transform as connections and fermions as sections in the fiber problem. And to allow different masses for fermions and bosons, please, we don't know, they should have the same mass. And try to implement supersymmetry as a gauge symmetry, as a local symmetry. See if we can do that. So this is what I'm going to tell you about. Let's try an example. So the idea is to combine bosons and fermions in a different way. And the starting point of one observation that is naive, but it might be interesting and actually proves reproducible, is to see that in three dimensions there is an interesting coincidence. That they were derived in any term is the bilinear and the fermions, and it's a first order differential equation. And for a connection, for a U1 field, you also have the bilinear object, which has one derivative, and that's the three-dimensional Sir Simon's curve. So these two things seem to be possible to combine in the same object, the same entity. So the idea is to take the connection and a spin one half field and combine them into a connection like the gauge connection. Where now this is the linear combination of the field A. One form, and some generator of symmetry corresponding to that object. And here we have the fermions and some generator of supersymmetry. And then you have to add more things because you need to close the algebra. Actually, you can try different things and this actually works. So the simplest way to do this, at least in three dimensions, is to add the generator of V1 symmetry, two generators of supersymmetry, and the conjugate. And you have to include also generators and rotation algebra in three dimensions. So you need to introduce the Lorentz group, which is a surprising way, because you didn't know that you had to introduce the Lorentz group. Actually, that's the way it works. So if you work out the algebra of these generators, and this is an algebra which is known, it's a classical super algebra, OSP22. So they have bosons, and they have a closed algebra, and the fermions close on the bosons. Okay. Now, if you write down the connection, you actually have to include more things. So you have to include the generator of rotations and the corresponding H field. So you have spin connection, you choose to draw in because you need to close the algebra. And also, you need to include something here that makes this turns this into a one form. This is a zero form, therefore you need to include a one form, and that projects the Clifford valid forms, the zero forms in the tangent space, to the base manifold. So for that you need to introduce the gamma matrices and the field values. So in order to make this program work, you need to introduce the field value, which is another surprise. We didn't expect that the metric would be brought in a natural way here, but it has to be done. So with this construction, you have a U1 connection, a spin connection, the field length and the thermics, and spin one half thermics. And this is all you need. So when you have a connection of an algebra, you can write down the Cantano's form in three dimensions. That's the expression that you have here. This is an invariant under the gauge group. And when you expand this in terms of the fields that I just mentioned, this is what you get. So you get a very ordinary looking Lagrangian. Actually, you get a U1 transcendence term. You get a transcendence term from gravity in social dimensions. You get the Dirac operator coupled to, minimally coupled to U1 and to the spin connection, coupled to, you even get the square root of G here. The only new thing that appears is that it's a combination of the bilinear term of thermics with some bosonic field accompanying it, which is a new term, which is essentially proportional to the torsion. This T is the torsion coming from the field. So this torsional coupling is sort of a master with thermics. Now, if you look at the field equations are very important as well. We'll be very respectfully important. This is what you get. You get a field equation for the U1 field, which is standard Einstein's field equation, where the current here is the standard electric current for the thermics. For the gravity part, we have the curvature proportional to some bilinear term in terms of thermics, which is some sort of cosmological constant. This were a constant, it would be a number, but it could be also considered a thing in dark energy. Now, for the thermics, you have the Dirac equation and the mass term appears, which tends to be the torsional term. So, what we have is a standard theory in two dimensions where the thermics pick up some mass that is brought in by the torsion. Now, the equation that we have for the curvature is interesting because it means that the torsion mass is covariantly constant. In this equation, so if we have some bilinear in the field, it implies that the torsion has to be constant. Therefore, this can be proven to be a number. So what does this theory describe? Okay, let's look at this equation in the vector of zero thermics. So let's look at the vacuum, see what happens when you take the vacuum. So if you take the vacuum, you get rid of all the right-hand side of this equation, and the other two equations become identical. And then you have this F equals zero and R AB equals zero. So it's like no electromagnetic field, and that's space time. But it's actually not so trivial, because this theory has torsion in it, so having vanishing two-form in curvature doesn't mean that the space is really flat. So let's see what happens. So here you have the zero two-form for electromagnetism, it means that A is the total derivative, and now it depends on the topology whether this is trivial or not. And in the case of the curvature, the fact that the curvature is proportional to the frequency means that this, as I said, this, the torsion is covariantly conserved. And this means essentially that this combination is a constant. So there is a fermionic mass brought in by the torsion, and it's compatible with these two equations. Now, since the torsion is not equal to zero, that means RAB is not a Riemann tensor, it has some other components, because the connection has the contortion term. So there is a torsion-free part, and there is a contortion. And the curvature has the torsion-free part of the curvature, but there is some other junk. So the whole thing here, this whole expression is equal to zero. But that means that this is not necessarily equal to zero. And especially if you have the fact that the torsion is not necessarily zero, but it's a constant, then you have more stuff there. So what you can show is that the torsion is given by this, is a covariant and constant object, and the curvature is given by this. This is the Riemann tensor now. So the solution of this equation corresponds to a constant curvature, constant torsion theory, and constant Riemann curvature. And this constant is essentially the integration constant for the torsion. So you have a theory which has as the solution its vacuum state, an anti-zither space. This is a three-dimensional anti-zither space, which has to come. And this cosmology of consonants is an integration cosmology. Now this space has well-known non-trivial solutions, black holes and stuff like that, and these black holes might be supersymmetric in the sense that they're EPS space and as an time spinners, but that's another story. So you can also take this solution, the vacuum solution, perturb small, make small perturbations to the premise, and to first of the equations for the connections that don't change. Okay. Now if you look at the flat background, you have other equations and you can also solve them in very interesting solutions there. Now what happens to the gravitino? If you do supergravity, if you do supersymmetric extension of ordinary gravity, you're forced to bring in the spin free half field, the gravitino. Well, here you didn't find the gravitino. And the reason is the following. If you take a small transformation, the OSP22 transformation, the gauge transformation near the identity, where this generator is a linear combination of the generators of the the transformation for the connection is given by the standard formula. And this contains all the expected symmetries, the U1 symmetry, also the U1 symmetry, that's the Lorentz group, and the supersymmetry. And the carriers of those interactions, or the connection fields for those are these, the U1 field, the spin connection, and the fermion. But there's no gravitino here. So the reason there is no gravitino is as follows. If you look at the transformations for the connection and the spin one half, the spin spin connection and so forth, you have these equations which are quite standard. Now, the field line doesn't have to change. I mean, the field line is equal, doesn't transform under this local supersymmetry. It doesn't participate. That means that the metric is inverse, supersymmetric carrying. That means in this background, in this geometry, the supersymmetry doesn't alter the metric background. Now, the metric is a composite object, it's very bilinear in the field line, and it's not a fundamental field, therefore. And the connection is can be solved in terms of the other fields, in terms of the field line and the inverse of the field line. And the supersymmetric invariant transformation here doesn't require a gravitino because this is the spin one half field. It's not spin three halves. Now, the way the gravitino would appear is as this combination, but this is not a fundamental field. This is a fundamental field. This is just an accompanying term, which comes from the spin one half, the spin, the field line and the matrix, the right matrices. So it's this combination that gamma is essentially a combination of the, it's a projection of the right matrices onto the right. Now since the field line doesn't change and the supersymmetry, this combination doesn't change. And therefore you can pass this variation onto the spin one half field, and this equation can be written this way. This gamma mu times delta psi equals to the gradient of the inversion parameter. And therefore you can multiply by gamma mu on this side, and this is the transformation of. Now, in order for these two equations to be compatible, you need this gradient of this inner spin one half field satisfy this constraint. Now this constraint is the projector, and this projector tells you that the spin three half component of this object is equal to zero. So actually, in this theory, you have projected out the spin 3 half field. And the question is whether you can do this consistently. The fact is that you can do it consistently because this operator is just made with gamma matrices and the field lines, and the field lines don't change in the supersymmetry, and therefore this operator commutes to supersymmetry. And now this can be done in many dimensions, not only in dimension 3, it can be done in B dimensions, and the projector can also be done this way. Actually, it's a funny story that the standard supersymmetry theory of 1974 by West and Sumino, they had this projector. So they had the choice of doing gauge theory, gauge supersymmetry without symmetry halves, but with symmetry halves. And they chose to do it the other way. So with the bifurcation that they took one branch of the bifurcation, rotating the other. Now this trick can be done in any dimensions, so in particular you can chance to do the transform, for instance, in five dimensions with similar construction, you would get a supersymmetric extension of the Lorentz group in five dimensions with more generators and bosons, bosons and stuff like that. And again, you can proceed in the same way. Now, let me summarize. Well, the standard approach to supersymmetry can consist of taking fermions and bosons in multiplets, in vectors, that transform in as a representation of global now, if you want to do it globally, you have to bring in a spin recap because you have to have a supersymmetric partner for the metric. And if you try to do realistic particle models for this, you have to introduce also supersymmetry breaking mechanisms. In this approach here, we have a supersymmetric extension on standard, any standard gauge symmetry actually, with all fields being part of the big connection. Fermions and bosons play roles that are the standard roles in fiber bundle. Fermions are sections and bosons are connections in any, like in any other under gauge theory. Now, fermions and bosons don't come in supersymmetric partners. There's no couples of one boson and one fermion. Actually, they form a combined object with all of them taking part in the symmetry. The global supersymmetry includes gravity and but not permittivity. And the bosons remain massless in the field equations that I wrote. There's no mass for the fermions, for the bosons. And the fermions can pick up a mass that is dropped by the torsion. So the mass of the fermions is a consequence of the background geometry. It's not something intrinsic, it's not a parameter in the gravity. Now, what I find most interesting about this construction is that gravity is brought in by the fermions. The fact that you have charged fermions and local supersymmetry implies that you have to close the algebra, you need to introduce the Lorentz spin connection. And also you need to introduce the field line. So the geometry of the metric structure is brought in by the fact that you have fermions. The gravitini, that's essentially this combination of the spin 1/2 and this object. So this is not a fundamental field. Gravitini are not fundamental fields in this construction. In the same way that the metric is not a fundamental field in this construction. The gravity is not a fundamental field. So in this construction, essentially the reason you have geometry, you have general relativity or gravity is because of the fermions. If you had no fermions in it, you would need not to introduce a metric or spin connection. What more or less is that there's no matching necessarily implied in between bosons and fermions. You have equal masses for particles of different spin. There's no mass generation. The fermion mass comes from the coupling to the torsion background torsion. The fermion mass is related to the topological constants. They are not independent parameters in this case. And these are both configuration constants. They are not fundamental constants in the magic. Now we can extend it to other things, and we are working on applications to for this matter physics, which in where 2-dimensional might be relevant. And for that, you have to work the non-relativistic limit of this theory. You can also do the high dimensions, and this is also something we're doing now, and to apply to other gauge groups. And many other things can come in the future. So this is all. Thank you very much.
Doesn't it bother you that your vacuum is crazy yesterday?
Not at all. It doesn't bother me.
Where is flat space time?
Well,
we don't live in Napier Street.
Well, we don't know where we live actually. The cosmological constant can be very small and you will be undetectable. So it will be very difficult to see whether maybe S with cosmological constant 10 to minus 500 for a flat space. For us, it doesn't make any difference.
But you have a negative one, not a constant.
Yes, negative. Yes, sure. I'm comfortable with that. You see.
Another point is your boson masses. You said they're massless, right?
Right.
But how do you know they stay massless on the one?
Well, this is the classical theory, of course. you can have vacuum expectation value coming from some comment that I have nothing in what that is. Well, this is, first of all, this is the top one. This is in 3 minutes. If you want to do the same thing in 5 or higher dimensions, 3 and 4 dimensions, you have to work harder. You have to do other things. So this is not the end of the story. Now, although you don't put it mass in the Lagrangian, that doesn't mean that you don't have an integration constant like mass. For instance, in the case of gravity, in 2+1 dimensions, you don't have a mass brought in the Lagrangian. But the fact that you have a small constant allows you to introduce an integration constant, which is a mass for black hole, for instance. And that is a conserved charge, that's a conserved quantity, that will remain there. So once you form that solution, their solution will be stably assigned to that number. So you would have massive black holes in 2+1 dimensions without having a mass in the Lagrangian. The same way here, you don't have a mass in the Lagrangian, and you have a small constant, which is an integration constant. And you can have massive black holes, for instance. So massive bosons or massive states may exist. And they may even be stable, like the black holes that can be EDS states. So they could be protected from decay or whatever. But still, they're not parameters for any classical elementary.
How about chiral symmetry? Do you have for Fermion?
Well, I suppose if you work with a multiplet in which you have a fairness in the chiral representation, let's say that had a fairness or something, in even dimension, then you will have.
But that would protect them from getting a mass, and yours are mass.
Yeah, but this framework, the Chan-Simons framework, doesn't work in even dimensions as, in the same way. I mean, the only way to get some theory in even dimensions is to, in this way of approaching, is to start with an all dimensional Chan-Simons theory, go to the boundary, or take some Kaluza line reduction to go to even dimensions. By doing that, you introduce extra things like breaking or chiral symmetry, chiral reflective symmetry, or some other things. So, I mean, the whole story is that does not end here. There are many other things that can be done.
Thank you.
So, you already referred to
the fermion mass comes from the torsion. Torsion is something that has been neglected consistently in gravity. Nobody actually takes it seriously. However, torsion is a necessary ingredient if you assume that the geometry is described by a metric structure, the theorem, and a fine structure, the Lorentz group. If you have those two fields independently, then there's no reason to assume that torsion mass vanishes. Actually, torsion equal to zero is a very ugly constraint in gravitation theory. So, if you don't assume that the torsion vanishes, you're bound to have mass for fermions. Even in the Dirac equation in the ordinary 3+1 geometry, essentially the same effect occurs in the Dirac equation in 3+1. You would have a mass coming from the torsion.
In three dimensions, we have two different definitions for linear methods. This has to subsequent the schema of the methods appear in the equation. Do you have the same problem with the methods given by the torsion?
No, it's a different story. You have two representations of the Dirac matrices in three dimensions, certainly. But the fact that the fermion has a mass comes only from the sign of the curvature terms. Let me try to point out where it appears. Here. The fact that the torsion has a parameter, which could be positive or negative, and the fact that the curvature comes with this sign, is a consequence of the fact of this equation that the curvature, this part, has the quadratic term in the torsion and has the right sign, the unique sign, it cannot be changed. So this doesn't change the fact that the Dirac operators do possible derivations.
Any other comment or question? No, thank you very much.